take a minute to appreciate our two musicians? Please stand if you are able and join me in our call to worship. Grace to you and peace from the one who is and who was and who is to come.
And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts.
The whole earth is full of God's glory.
Trusting in the power of God, not only to fashion the world, but to mend and refashion our hearts. Our gathering hymn is number 154 in the Red Hymnal, verses 1, 2, 4, and 6.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
You may be seated. Friends, just a couple of things to chat about this morning. First of all, doesn't this place look gorgeous? And aren't you loving not being able to see the screens? It's actually our method to require you to move to a different pew. To shake things up a little. We're going to be working to figure out some of the visual aspects of this as we move forward, but there's an invitation throughout the next couple of weeks for you guys to bring an ornament that may be special to you, and we will hang them across the top. So if you have an ornament, or if you want to purchase a special ornament that represents something that's important to you or your family, we invite you to bring that, and we'll hang them on the light strips, and we'll all kind of represent who we are as the people of grace. With that, we know that poinsettias are also an important part of decorating, and the sign-up sheet for poinsettias are on the desk, so we have a couple more available, and we can always get more if need be. They're $25, and we're asking that also you would help deliver those after Christmas to somebody who is shut in or at home, and so there's a question that says delivery, and that is, will you take your poinsettia that you've purchased and deliver that to somebody who we can just brighten their holiday up a little? Last but not least, I just want to thank everyone who made all of the things happening yesterday happen. We had a team at EUM first thing yesterday morning making sandwiches to go to people as they attended the free store. We had a big team of people here for yesterday's worship service and celebration of life for Betty Scholes. Then everybody came back and decorated, and then we had the Transgender Day of Remembrance ceremony last night. So it was a full day, and there were so many people. We thank you all for all of your hard work and dedication to making this a place of hospitality and a place where people can connect with God. So thank you. Friends, let us enter into a time of prayer as we begin this worship service this morning. Holy God, we don't know how to pray, but Jesus invites us into the life he shares with you. And so we keep coming because we want to live. Receive us now in our frailty, our complacency, and our desire. We pray for your church all over the world. May the life we discover in you bind us to each other and to the world you love. For no need is beyond the strength of your call, and no child of yours is expendable. Merciful God, give us wisdom and courage beyond our imagining. We pray for each leader who might be an instrument of peace in a troubled land. By the movement of your reconciling spirit, bless your people with the courage to reach past old wounds and persistent fears. God of resurrection, bring life where hope has died. We pray for friends and strangers in the grip of addiction. Make us able companions for each other and bless us with hope that bears fruit. We pray for unsettled economies and those whose needs are overlooked in the choices of the powerful. May we, who know so much privilege, bear our responsibilities with open eyes and open hearts. We pray for all who stand at the thresholds of life, your children who are soon to be born, and your children who are soon to go home. We give thanks for new faces to love, ideas to ponder, work to do, and we marvel at the sturdy friendships and persistent memories that sustain us when the way is hard. May each be a reminder of your love and your provision. We thank you for the gift of song, for notes that speak when words fail, and choirs that practice at the end of long days. Give strength to leaders who call forth the best from us and invite us to breathe together. Holy One, keep calling us into the world, your world as salt and light. Equip each of us for the challenges we will face until we learn to worship in the most unlikely places. For you are the source of our song and the well from which we pray whenever we are planted, wherever we are planted. Holy God, you know our needs even before we ask, so hear now our prayers in secret. We acknowledge that we are gathering on the traditional territories of the indigenous people. We affirm that settlers have specific responsibilities in the journey of reconciliation. The Niitsi Tape, the Absaluke, the Cheyenne, the Ocheti, Shokowin. We give thanks to the Creator and to those people who have stewarded this land for generations. And we are grateful for the opportunity to live, work, and worship here. By the power of your Spirit, we make our prayer with resurrection hope. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Spirit of truth, move now in ancient words and cluttered hearts that we may hear your voice and live, for we long to be glad servants of your hidden holy reign. A reading from 2 Samuel, Chapter 23, verses 1 through 7. Now these are the last words of David. The oracle of David, son of Jesse, the oracle of the man whom God exalted, the anointed of the God of Jacob, the favorite of the strong one of Israel. The Spirit of the Lord speaks through me. His words is upon my tongue. The God of Israel has spoken. The Rock of Israel has said to me, one who rules over people justly, ruling in the fear of God, is like the light of morning, like the sun rising on a cloudless morning, gleaming from the rain on the grassy land. Is not my house like this with God? For he has made with me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things and secure. Will he not cause to prosper all my help and all my desire? But the godless are like thorns that are thrown away, for they cannot be picked up with the hand. To touch them, one uses an iron bar or the shaft of a spear, and they are entirely consumed in the fire on the spot. Hear what the Spirit is saying for God's people. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hosanna. And working with the cantata on Sunday afternoons, I have so much more appreciation for some of those rhythms. Friends, we come to that time where we greet one another in the peace of Christ. We know that everybody has different comfort levels surrounding COVID, and so we invite you just to be cautious of that as you engage with people. But let us greet one another this morning. Friends, as we gather back this morning, friends, we invite you to center yourself back into a time of prayer as we sing our next hymn. Following that, we'll lift up our joys and concerns together, followed by a pastoral prayer and then the Lord's Prayer. I know I say it most weeks, but we understand that we say our Creator on our screen here. That is to acknowledge God without gender. But we invite you to say the prayer in whatever way is comfortable for you. I'm a sinner. You may be a trespasser. Some people are debtors. We all end together with a glorious amen. And so let us sing our way into prayer this morning, singing, "He is exalted." Are there joys and concerns we'd like to lift up today? Yeah, Cheryl. Church gets 10%. So we lift up our card ministry to our college students and people in prison and invite you to sign those cards in the narthex today. They need to go out tomorrow. And then also just lifting up the current pandemic and the stress and strain it's placing on lots of different professionals, but especially our medical staff during this time. And just pray for people to continue to make safe choices. Yeah, Mary, sorry. Thank you. All right. So just a blessing to the ministry of our Adopt the Unit. So Billings Clinic asked churches around town to adopt a certain unit, and we have the radiology department. And so we have been able to gift them with goodies and thank you cards and Jeep made cards for them. And City Brew has offered us a grant so that we're able to give them coffee coupons as well so they can go get coffee with our next round. So thank you for your generosity. Also, we continue to lift up our transgender community following last night's Transgender Day of Remembrance ceremony. It's a hard place to be trans, and we continue to just encourage inclusivity in our community. Yes. So for the loss of a young man to COVID, the joy of having your grandchild with you this morning, and continued prayers for the family on their journey of grief. Yeah, Kayla? Okay. So for prayers for your friend Michael, who is still positive with COVID, but recovering and hopefully a negative test soon. Yeah, Judy. For the joy of growth and community. Friends, we all make a choice when we wake up on Sunday morning to come and to worship God. And I know, just like you, there are Sundays that I don't want to be here. And I would rather be in my PJs. So thank you for making the choice to be part of the community and to give your hearts to God during this time. Seeing no other joys or concerns, let us be in an attitude of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we thank you so much for this place and these people, that as we gather together, we share our hearts with one another and most importantly with you, that we rely on each other's smiles and friendly hugs to strengthen us for the week to come and to comfort us from the week before. Lord, we lift up all of the joys and concerns shared here aloud today and the ones that remain on our hearts, knowing that each one of us are on our own journey, but knowing that because we walk it with you and with one another, the journey seems slightly less burdened. Lord, we lift up our world, the brokenness that we're seeing in our country, the divides over politics and race. May we be instruments of peace and reconciliation. May we continue to fight the good fight, and may we remember why we do it. Lord, we lift up our trans community as they celebrate another year of being who they are, and as they mourn the loss of those whose lives were taken by violence just because they claim to be who you created them to be. Lord, we continue to be a place of refuge and safety for all people. May we continue to ask tough questions. May we continue to seek change and transformation. And so, Lord, in the tradition of your church, we pray the way your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Our children are excused for Sunday school, if you want to go with Miss Verna. A reading from the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to the author of John. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, Are you the king of the Jews? Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priest have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So are you a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So a lot of king and Christ language today. It is the reign of Christ, or King Sunday, which is wrapping up the liturgical calendar for the year as we begin Advent. Here's one of the interesting things about this special Sunday that we call Christ the King Sunday. It was created in our liturgical calendar for only political reasons. What a shocker, the church was political. Right, so throughout centuries, we've had these special seasons and holidays where they mean so much to us in the calendar of the year, the cycle that we go from Jesus' birth to the death and resurrection through ordinary time. But in the 1920s, right after World War I, the Pope decided we needed a special Sunday to remind people who the true king was. This wasn't because he was concerned that people were really failing to understand the significance of Christ. It was that there were kings and kaisers and czars that were taking over, and he really wanted to make a political affront against them. And so we get this special holiday that is gifted to us by politics of World War I. But it does make me think about what it is we're looking for in a king when we refer to Jesus as a king. When we talk about Christology, it's a fun term, we're going to learn a little theology today, there is a spectrum of understanding who Jesus is. High Christology, right, the study of Christ, ology, right, study of Christ, pretty obvious. On a high Christology end of the spectrum, what we're talking about is people who really believe in the Jesus that we see in the Gospel of John. Son of God, miraculous, not of this world, very unhuman, right? Very godly. What we call a low Christology is when we refer to the Jesus that walks right next to us and is our best friend sitting at the table. Less godly. Less of a deity, more human, right? So we focus on the human elements. So I would imagine in this church, we have very few, maybe a few, people on the really high end of Christology. We're probably more moderate to low Christology on a regular day. And I'll tell you, it's a pendulum that shifts, right? Some days I need the big Jesus who is the Son of God, and the other day I need the Jesus who is going to just sit with me and complain about the complacent people in my church. It's okay that this is a pendulum for us, right? Faith and theology is a pendulum. We shift. Things don't remain always rooted in one thing that we learned. I was thinking about how shifts in my life have happened. I've told you many times that I always wanted to be a politician. I really am like a challenger, you know, want to get right at things. You know my personality well enough now to kind of see how I lead and choose to do things. I have always, when I've worked in different places, admired working for very strong, independent women. It's probably because I have dad issues. I've seen a therapist, we're okay. Right? Don't all young gay boys have some daddy issues? Anyway, so throughout my time in my career, learning to grow, I immediately found myself in ministry working in the bishop's office at a very young age. That was a pretty big power move for me, right? Made me feel really important, like I was in the know. And it made me feel like my career was going to be this great trajectory right to bishop. I don't want to be a bishop. I'm not quite convinced I know what they do. But I love them. When I moved to Denver to go to seminary, I found myself again working in a conference center. And this time, I worked for one of the most strategically minded human beings I have ever met in my life, who is still one of my greatest mentors. She was supposed to officiate Adam and I's wedding. She is this short little Korean woman, and she acts as if she is 7 foot tall and 300 pounds. That woman moves mountains. Moves mountains. And while I got to work in her office, I often found myself in spaces with intimate knowledge that I probably shouldn't have known. Right? Have you ever been in these places in life when you just know? You worked in HR, of course you know these types of things. Well, here's one of the interesting things about knowledge. Some of us, when it gets a little too far to our head, allow knowledge to become power. Knowledge becomes power. And it can be a very dangerous power when we use it to push our own agendas, or we do it to push ourselves ahead, and we use that knowledge in ways that we're not supposed to. So one day, I was having a tough conversation with a colleague, and finally, a sweet, kind person in the office said, "Can you come into my office?" I knew that this was going to be one of those tough conversations, right? Immediately knew it. I probably had overstepped with information I knew and was probably being a little power hungry. So I sat down with this dear friend, and she said, "Sometimes when we work in places where we think the stakes are really high, we begin to use our knowledge and our power in ways to influence our own agendas that aren't healthy. And I want to encourage you to think about how you may choose to lead differently." I was crushed, right? Anytime we get this type of feedback from somebody we love and care about, we know we've overstepped. We've broken a boundary. We've broken the social contract. And I sat there starting to get defensive, like we most do when we receive feedback we don't want to hear. And then she looked at me so politely and said, "There's something my mom used to teach me all the time. Before we say something, we should ask ourselves, is it true? Is it kind? And most importantly, is it necessary?" Is it true? Is it kind? Is it necessary? Now, I gossip just like the rest of you. But when we think about asking ourselves these three questions before we share information, typically, it is true in our minds. And sometimes we feel like we're entitled to say things because it's kind to be honest with people. But the real question is it necessary to say it? Is it necessary? Are we sharing the information because we feel like it's necessary to push our own agendas, to gain power or knowledge, or just gossip with the rest of the crowd? Or is it necessary for building the kingdom of God and the community we want to experience here? So I invite you in the next couple of weeks to ask yourself, is it true, is it kind, is it necessary, when you're engaging in conversation? So why are we talking about this? I think when we talk about Christ the King Sunday, one of the things that we learn about Jesus is Jesus chooses to lead differently. Jesus had a lot of knowledge and a lot of power. It's one of my favorite hymns. He could have called 10,000 angels, but chose not to show us the way that we have to live differently in this world. The story that we pick up in the gospel today is very strange, right? All of a sudden, we have Jesus speaking to Pilate right before we start Christmas. It reminds me of the communion on Christmas Eve. I hate it because I can't celebrate the baby Jesus and eat him at the same time. It grosses me out. But let's think back to our Lenten journey and think about what has led Jesus up to this place. Jesus is gathered, they've sat at the table, he's offered bread and wine and given this new covenant to his disciples. The betrayer has already betrayed Jesus. They go to the garden to pray. They pray with one another. The disciples, like most of us, got a little sleepy and took a nap while Jesus was doing the hard work. And then all of a sudden, this group of people show up, and in the arrest, they ask Jesus the same question. It starts in verse 4. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and they fell on the ground. We missed this part a lot. They fell on the ground. Again, he asked them, "Who are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus said, "I told you that I am he. So if you were looking for me, let these men go." And then what happens? Peter takes out a sword and chops off somebody's ear. Jesus, in that moment, by the people that were about to arrest him and commit violence against him, stands proud of who he is and offers a way of nonviolence. And yet, we as disciples are people who continue to perpetuate violence, just like Peter. Right? Nadia Bowles Weber talks about this text. She's a pastor, a Lutheran pastor, and she says, the problem when we read a text like this is I'm the person with the sword. So passionate about protecting Jesus, we decide to respond in the way that the world has taught us by use of force and violence as opposed to the way that Jesus was modeling. Is it true? Is it kind? Is it necessary? See, in the life of our communities, we as churches have perpetuated violence against lots of people. I wasn't shocked last night when somebody at the Transgender Day of Remembrance ceremony said, maybe if we didn't do it at church, we'd have better attendance. Each week at Rainbow Coffee House, we have kids that walk in and say, is this really a church? Because we know that the violence that we've committed against LGBTQ people is extreme in the life of Christendom. But this church answered a call and chose to go a different direction. But that doesn't mean that all churches are creating safe space for all people. And we know that we're not just the rainbow church and the gay church just because we have a gay pastor. We're a church that values the inclusivity of all people, no matter where they're at. That all people are welcome to come here and to ask questions. And in the midst of it, we have to do the hard work of continuing to create the safe community amongst one another. Is it true? Is it kind? Is it necessary? I hate using king language to talk about God. In my board of ordination interviews to become a pastor, oftentimes I get nailed on this question. How do you respond to the phrase, "Christ is Lord"? For me, it brings images of violence and a God with a sword and wrath. And for me, that's when I lean on that low Christology of the Jesus who modeled for us right before he was arrested, that nonviolence is the way that we have to live in this world. Right in front of the people who betrayed him, a disciple who chose violence when Jesus had taught nothing but nonviolence. And continues to call us into community. I'm going to go there this morning, my friends. It reminds me of the controversial topic of the American flag in the sanctuary. Yesterday, we were decorating the tree, and somebody said, "Oh, don't move the flag," and that was great. And Adam quipped up. He's not here today. He's sick. But Adam quipped up and said, "Oh, Sam wouldn't even let them have a flag in their sanctuary at his last church." And it's true. I wouldn't let them. Until we had a very important conversation. You see, for me, the flag stood as a symbol of staking claim by saying, this is American soil, and when we are in the house of God, this is not America, this is God's place of refuge. And I used to fight that fight. You know why? Because in seminary, they make us really, really laser focused on debates like this. deep theological questions. It's kind of like when you get your master's or you become a school teacher and then your friend becomes an administrator and they say they lose half of their brain when they go to administrative school. Right? It's what we do to pastors too. Right? We become so laser focused. And so in the midst of this conversation about the flag, we started to talk and one of the people said, well, that's not what the flag means to me at all. And so we find that as we have different perspectives, right, as we learn from one another, as we grow, for many people, staking the flag isn't a place of claim of American soil. It stands for so many different things. It is violent to remove a flag just because my theology says it's inappropriate to have it here. Jesus offers us the way of nonviolence to say that all things can exist. Right, in the same way that we can say mother or father or creator and still worship the same God. Because it is about helping all of us find better ways to connect to God. We commit violence in different ways in the church that are much more subtle than a gun or removing somebody's ear with a sword. We do it when we push our own personal agendas. We do it when we choose to gossip. We do it when we don't ask the questions, is it true, is it kind, and is it necessary? That's the king we're learning and living into. That's the model Jesus is offering us for us to explore and understand transformed lives. And as we continue to do church together, we're going to live in the messy. We're going to have tough conversations, and we're going to continue to lean into the ways that we don't commit acts of harm against one another or the wider community we try to serve. But first, we're going to ask ourselves, is it true? Is it kind? And is it necessary? Thanks be to God. Amen.
At Grace United Methodist Church, we appreciate all the ways that our members contribute towards building a strong community through ministry. Here's a look at some of the ways you can help through your time and involvement. It's almost time for an annual tradition here at Grace, the Angel Tree. We are so excited to be able to once again help bring Christmas cheer to families here in our community. The volunteers at Rainbow Coffee House are working to establish a food pantry to ensure that those who are food insecure have a healthier experience once they leave the coffee house. Shelf-stable items such as ramen, soup, granola bars, protein bars, pudding and fruit cups, microwave mac and cheese, as well as other non-perishable goods would be best. If you are interested in helping, please get in touch with Pastor Sam. Want to take part in the annual Christmas Cantata? Join us for rehearsals every Sunday at 2 p.m. If you have questions or want to know more, please touch bases with Leanne after the service. Want to have some fun and engage with others in the Grace community? Join us every Tuesday from 1 to 3 p.m. for Pinochle Tuesdays. Meal and Meditation is a fellowship group that meets Tuesdays at 5 p.m. in the Fireside Room at Grace to share a meal, express concerns, uplift one another, and occasionally pursue some type of study. Everyone is welcome to attend. Grace United Methodist will be having a food drive for the Billings Food Bank this month. The food bank is specifically requesting foods that are appropriate for holiday meals, such as stuffing mixes, canned vegetables and fruit, cranberries, pie mixes, and other items. You may make the donation to the food bank when you turn in your pledge card. That's all for today. To find out more, please check out our Facebook page or visit our website at graceumcbillings.org. Thank you for being a part of Grace United Methodist Church.
Friends, we continue to encourage you to give in ways that are meaningful, right? But engagement is more important than attendance. And so we love the way that we continue to serve this community and the people of this church in so many ways with our gifts and our talents. We invite you to give in the offering plate, which is in the back of the sanctuary, or online with information on the screen. There is one more announcement that I failed to put in the list, and that is that our prayer group is going to start meeting at 8 a.m. during Advent and doing a special prayer time. Now, I have never attended because they typically meet at 6:30, and nothing good happens before 8:30. So this is still a stretch for me, but I encourage you, if you're looking for a prayerful way to dive into the Advent season, something different, a little addition to your spiritual walk, that this is an amazing way to do so. Yeah, Loween, do you want to say more? Absolutely. So in the fellowship hall, around the Christmas tree, Pastor Sam in his pajamas, and we will be there. So I invite you to consider that if you're looking for something else. Friends, today is a glorious day in church. It is Pledge Card Sunday. And not that church should always revolve around money, but it is an important part of our spiritual discipline. It used to make me really grossed out when churches talked about money, and then finally I had a pastor who said, if you're not looking at how you spend your money, then you're not looking at what value you have on money, and the way you spend your money says a lot about your values. And so we are thankful for the commitments that people make in the life of this community to make sure things continue to grow and to move forward. The finance team is meeting early this week and will assess the pledges that we have, and then we'll relook at the budget to see if it's even sustainable for us to work with the proposed budget that we place before you. I can tell you, as of yesterday, we had received several pledge cards and were just over $65,000 committed. And so we know that every amount and commitment allows us to better plan for the future of ministry next year and the life of the church. And so we're going to do a special blessing over these pledges and these commitment cards. Friends, if you didn't get a pledge card, there are still some in the back and they're available. If nothing else, if this is important to you, on the pledge card there is a box that just says, I believe that God is calling Grace UMC to be a safe refuge for all people and will commit to the ministries of the church with my prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. And I invite you just to grab a card, put your name on it, and check that box and commit in that way. If you still have your pledge card and want to bring it forward, we can do that as well. Don't want it not to get blessed, Cheryl. Well, now that I know you did your will and put the church in it. All right, friends, well, we're going to practice our prayer group stuff right now. I'm going to invite each of you to put a hand out as we bless this basket, knowing that these are people's gifts, things giving back to the church, their commitment to seeing the ministry grow here at Grace United Methodist Church. Gracious and loving God, giver of all that is good and true and beautiful and life-giving, these cards represent our sweat. They represent our lives. They represent our dreams. The pledges which we make on them are but tokens of the awesome gifts that have been given to us, and they are pledged in thanksgiving for all we have received, for all we have been inspired to be, for all we are challenged to become in this place. May they be the first fruits of all we have and not what we have left over, so that we may live out as closely as possible how you give to us. May we see them as our offering to you, sacred, holy, yet earthly, filled with possibility. May we hold this image in our hearts and minds, so as we watch our offerings each week come to your table, we can see our very lives and selves being part of this offering. It is on this table, living sacrifices to you, in the name of the Creator, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Alrighty, friends, let us stand and sing our closing song. This is a new one. It is beautiful. If nothing else, enjoy the lyrics. It's a slower song, and I'm sorry to go out on a slower tone, but this is, I believe, Grace Ministry at its best and what we affirm as people here. Friends, receive this blessing in the name of the Creator, Son, and Holy Spirit. Go forth in peace. Amen.